last night was absolutely invaluable on giving the basics of how do you operate in the supernatural as a Christian. It was absolutely invaluable. The personal experience, the stories, that this is how it happened for me. Man, there's just no better way to explain it than this is how it happened for me. And this is what he did, and this was the results. And then this is how it happened for me, and just example after example after example, which goes hand in hand with where we're going. We're not quite there yet in our series on the Holy Spirit, but it goes hand in hand on it, because that is probably one of the biggest questions that people ask is, well, how do you operate in the Spirit? How do you operate in the supernatural? How do you give a word of knowledge? How do you? Last night, man, just plain nailed it to the wall. It was really good. And I want to touch something else that I've already spoke on, but here stands a living example, because it's one of the big controversial things of being saved, and do you get the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit when you're saved? We know we get the deposit, but, you know, some believe you get the baptism of the Holy Spirit when you're saved, when you're born again, and scripturally speaking, I don't see that being correct. The baptism in the Holy Spirit is a second experience. It's after salvation, typically speaking. And I thought, oh, well, I'm going to just point this out. This man is a living example of this, because he said the last time he came, he was not baptized in the Holy Spirit. He had never prophesied. He wasn't seeing any miracles. He wasn't seeing anything supernatural. So either we had an unbeliever here speaking, or he was saved the last time he was here speaking. Now, for those of you that were here the last time David was here speaking, you could sense the anointing. And if we'd ask him, I think he'd probably say, well, yeah, I was saved. But I didn't have that full experience of the Holy Spirit. Exactly. It's a second subsequent experience. It's a separate thing from salvation. And I just wanted to point that out, because it was so necessary to get that out for me, because it's one of the big controversies of, well, you're saved, you're already baptized in the Holy Spirit. No, you're not. And the proof of that is there's no power.
Amen.
I mean, that's proof of it. And he just gave example after example. He said, I've never done this before. He's been saved for years in the ministry. And then he got baptized in the Holy Spirit, and all of a sudden the supernatural stuff starts happening. Why? Because he got the power. So I just wanted to make sure everybody didn't miss that. So, I don't know where it's going, but hopefully you do. Come on, brother.
Amen.
Let's do it.
I'm definitely saved. Definitely saved. Let me pray before I start. Father, we thank you for your presence here. And as we were worshiping, Lord, that verse from Proverbs, in the face of the king, there his life was going over and over in my head. And so, Father, I ask that we will see your face tonight, that we will get a glimpse of who you are on a personal level, that whatever people need to take away from what I'm going to say will be personal and true to them, because it is the living word and it is the living God that is speaking personally. So in your face, God, that people will see life, and as a representation of you, people will see life in our face, because we represent the King of Kings. And so, Father, guide us, lead us tonight, Lord. That largest, smallest space from the brain to the heart, Lord, I pray you would take away distractions and let us get it in our hearts tonight, not just in our minds. That you would block it going out the other ear as it comes in one. And Father, I pray that you would take away all distractions tonight from my mind, from the hearts of people here, and that you would speak. Amen. Amen. So as I was driving up the road from Elk River, Lord, give me a word specifically for you tonight. and for me. And I was reading 2 Kings chapter 2 over the last couple of days, and I was reading about Elisha. And this is what stuck out to me. Elijah said, "What do you want, Elisha?" He said, "I want a double portion. I want double what you had, Elijah." And so tonight, that's what's on my heart. I want double what has come before. Revivals of the past, I want double. And so I don't want it to stop. I want double. And so Elijah's response was this: "You have asked a difficult question," verse 10. Elijah replied, "If you see me when I'm taken from you, then you will get your request. But if not, then you won't." This isn't on the slides. This is just fresh. And so Elijah knew, as a man, I can't give you what you're asking for. This is a big deal. But I know one who can, and it's the God who I serve. And so I know that whenever he's coming to take me, he's going to be there. And in his presence, what you ask for can happen.
Yes. Yes.
But then we read on further. As they walked along, verse 11, and talking, suddenly a chariot of fire appeared, drawn by horses of fire. It drove between the two men, separating them. And Elijah was carried by a whirlwind into heaven. So Elijah wasn't carried by chariots of fire into heaven. He was carried by a whirlwind. But what was the purpose of those chariots of fire? Because Elisha was told, "You need to see me going into heaven. You need to be obedient to what I'm telling you." And I believe the chariots of fire were a test of the signs and wonders. Are you looking at the signs and wonders, or are you focusing on God, on his face? Because in the face of the king, there is life. And so as we move as a church into this time of the anointing of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit, we need to make sure that we are not so focused on the gifts that we forget about the gift giver.
Amen.
And so Elisha had to remember, I need to focus on the gift giver, not this sign and wonder that's flying past me that probably would have been amazing and left you trembling at your feet. But the amazing thing was that I believe maybe Elisha would have missed the whole point, because it went on to say that Elisha saw it and cried out, my father, I see the chariots and the charioteers of Israel," as he disappeared from sight. Verse 13 says, Elijah picked up Elijah's cloak, which had fallen when he was taken up. Went on 14, it says, he struck the water with Elijah's cloak and cried out, "Where is the Lord God of Israel?" And the river divided and Elijah went across. I believe that as Elijah was caught up in this whirlwind to heaven, that his cloak would have been touched by the Father himself and descended back down to earth. And if Elisha would have missed that, if Elijah would have missed that moment because he was so focused on these chariots of fire, he would have missed where the cloak was that carried the anointing that he had asked for of double the portion. And so straight away, he started to walk in that double portion because he was so focused on God and not these signs and wonders. And so I believe God was speaking to me about that tonight. Elisha had the boldness to ask for something huge. He had the boldness to say, I want something that has never been done before or seen before, because Elijah was a pretty great man. Elijah done a lot of great stuff. He also had a lot of failures. But he had the boldness to ask for double. And so tonight, as we start this night of asking God for more, be bold.
Yeah.
I'm going to leave time at the end for ministry and for people to come up here and ask to be filled even more and to be sent out and set on fire, whatever it is. But be bold and ask for double, ask for treble, ask for a quadruple. I don't know.
Yeah, amen.
So tonight, I want to talk about looking back to the future. Back to the future. The origin of this talk comes a few weeks ago. I was going to a nursing home, and they call the same thing over here, an elderly home. And so I was going in to speak at this nursing home, and I thought to myself, I'm sure there's so many people just go in and preach at them and go in and say, well, I actually heard that one person had prayed, God, for the time they have left, let them be useful. I don't want to go in and do that. So I said, God, what words of life do you want me to bring to these people? Because that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to bring them words of life. And so I felt them saying, point them back to what God has done with them and what he's done with them. I'm repeating myself. So that they can use it right now to point people to you, to encourage the people that are looking after them, to encourage the people that come in and see them, that for what their life has stood for can still mean something right now. They can still give advice. They can still pray. They can still do and be effective. And so that's where this talk came from. I want us to look back, to point us to forward to the future, to propel us. The act of remembrance is so important. Does anybody remember their favorite meal and what it smelled like? I used to be called beefy at school because I was a pretty large guy. And it's because my mum used to have plates of food that you could climb over. But I remember coming in, and I remember whenever she had cooked my favorite with mash and gravy and mince and carrots, and I just remember coming in the door and smelling it because you knew, oh, that's what I want. I remember used to, when it came to spring, you could smell the fresh cut grass, or maybe you have a certain smell that reminds you of something great your mom or dad used to do, or of a place you used to go. I love the smell of going into the cinema. It just makes you feel excitement. It's good to remember. It's good for things in your life to cause you to remember. And this is a very important thing in the Christian life. The children of Israel were told to remember the Passover. And the purpose of remembering the Passover was not to keep them stuck in the past, but to propel them forward. For them to remember, this is how good God was and is to come.
Amen.
So it wasn't to be stuck in the past, just like we break the bread and drink the wine. It's not pointing back to what God has done, really. It's pointing forward to what he has already accomplished. It's saying to us, I've already done this for you, so live your life like I'm asking you to. There's a purpose in looking back to push forward, to say, trust me, have faith in me, look what I've already done for you. And so often they were told, make an altar to remember what I have done for you. Make a physical reminder that points to the fact that I was faithful to you, because we so easily forget. How many of us forget all the good things that God has done? And so when we get into a situation, we're just like, God, where were you? Where are you? But we fail to remember that every single time in my life, God has been faithful.
Amen.
The purpose of remembering is to bring knowledge, which helps us to understand grace. When we remember, we understand, God, you've brought me through so much. You forgive me of so much. You've given me so much grace. So I ask right now, as you propel me in the future, that I will show the same grace. That I will remember the grace that you poured upon me. In Psalm 78, 1-8, in the New Living Translation, it says this about looking back to the future. O my people, listen to my instructions. Open your ears to what I am saying. For I will speak to you in parables. I will teach you hidden lessons from our past, stories we have heard and known, stories our ancestors handed down to us. So first of all, that says to me, there's a reason why God is not just putting these things in plain sight. He says, I'm hiding them from you. And so whenever something is hidden from us, it makes us work. Because when we find it, it's like a gem that we hold up. It's like a prize that we say, look what we found. So as we search the scriptures, so as we get on our knees, as we push through the wall, as we seek for breakthrough in certain things in our life, it will be like a gem to us that will be like, this is what God has revealed to me in his living word. And I'm going to share it with you. It's the purpose of him giving you visions. They're not just for you. They're for you to share with others, to build the church up and encourage one another.
Amen.
And so he says, open your ears. It takes response. It takes action, because I want you to pass it on. This is what it says. Stories we have heard and known, stories our ancestors handed down to us. We will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord and about his power and his mighty wonders. For he issued his laws to Jacob and gave his instructions to Israel. He commanded our ancestors to teach them to their children, so the next generation might know them, even the children not yet born, and they in turn will teach their own children. So each generation should set its hope anew on God, not forgetting his glorious miracles and obeying his commands, then they will not be like their ancestors, stubborn. Stubborn. This sounds like my nation and this nation. Stubborn, rebellious, and unfaithful, refusing to give their hearts to God. The reason this country, in context of where I am now, is like this is because our ancestors have not looked back to where God has brought them from, of what this country was established on. And it's the same in my own country. And so we're told, teach it to the children. Like I said last night, let our ceiling be their floor to propel them forward. In the message it says this, listen to your friends, to God's truth. Bend your ear to what I tell you. I'm chewing on a morsel of a proverb. I let you in on the sweet old truths. Stories we heard from our fathers. Counsel we learned at our mother's knee. We're not keeping this to ourselves. We're passing it along to the next generation. God's fame and fortune, the marvelous things he has done. Let's become a people who pass on the great things that God has done.
Hallelujah.
In 2009, I had a dream about Cedar Rapids, which is the reason I'm standing here right now, all because of a dream. And so I decided to write a journal of the book of everything that we went through and still are going through. And I hope that someday my kids can read that book and see the faithfulness of God. But I also want to tell my kids stories. I want to impact the way they talk. On the way we were driving here tonight, my son wanted to give testimony. I've never heard him want to do that. So I turned the radio down and he says, Daddy, I just want to let you know that the other day when I was sick, I was feeling really, really sick. And I think he said, I asked God to make me better. And a God song came on, and after that, I was better. And I was like, good boy, you're getting it. You're getting it. And so I want to pass on my good habits, my godly habits, the things that I rely and trust in God that he comes through in. I want to share them with my son. I want to share them with my wife, with my grandparents, with my mom and my dad. My dad is still a Baptist pastor at heart. And so I don't go enforcing the things of the Spirit and the baptism of the Spirit, as a conversation we've had. I don't force those things on him, but what I do in relationship, I share the stories of what's happening. Yeah. He can't deny the stories and testimonies because it says I want to do it again.
Yeah.
And so experiencing God through what he has done in the past correctly positions us to experience God in what he is doing in the present. Let me say it again. This is Bill Johnson says this. Experiencing God through what he has done in the past correctly positions us to experience God in what he is doing in the present. He goes on to say that history is more than a series of random events. It is a story with a plot, characters, themes, and outcome. History is a story because it has an author. And so no matter what is happening in the media, no matter what our governments are saying is allowed, no matter what our states are saying is right and moral, it doesn't matter to the church. And please don't judge me yet. It doesn't matter who is in government. We are to pray for them. We are to get on our knees. And yes, but it doesn't ultimately matter because God knows the future. Because everything is in his control and in his hands.
Amen.
And so instead of us as Christians rising up on Facebook and saying this is a disgrace, we need to ask God, God, help us to search your word. Help us to have a character and a heart of love in how we respond to this. Because if not, we will make things worse and we will push people away. So we're going to trust you, God, that you are a God of the past, the present, and the future. So looking back, we see that you're faithful and we know that to this very day you will be faithful. So we will pray and we will act in a way of love. We will not just sit in our churches. We will get out the doors and we will be a people who respond through getting into your word and meditating on your scripture and being filled to overflow. And so that's the way this country will be changed.
Amen.
Not through us giving off about it and doing the usual where we have. Last night I talked about the funnel. It's turning it around the other way and seeking God and saying, God, give me the gift of wisdom on how to respond to this. Everything has a beginning and an end, and everything in between is simply God's faithfulness.
Yes.
Doesn't mean we be lazy. Doesn't mean we don't do anything. Yeah. But we need to remember back that God is and has always been faithful.
Amen.
In the dictionary, the word remembrance has four aspects to it. The first one is the act of remembering or a state of being remembered. It's an act. It's intentional. There's a purpose in why we remember. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. Two, something that is remembered or reminiscent, it takes time. We're supposed to take time to remember. I love reflecting. I said it last night from Psalm 51, creating me a clean heart. I love taking time to remember back to what I used to be. Sometimes I don't feel too far from it. But I remember what God saved me from, and it just stirs me. I remember the passion that I had when I first got saved. I remember how gullible I was, that I just was wanting to go out in the streets and tell people about Jesus, even though I didn't have a clue. Number three, it's a memento or keepsake. It's something that should be kept close to the heart. And we're talking about negative things and positive things. So lessons we've learned, we should remember them and keep them close to the heart, saying, God, I will never let you down like that again. I will never respond in that way. Or positively, God, I thank you, and I will not forget your faithfulness in the past as I move forward.
Amen.
And four, it is the extent in time of one's power of recollection. We need to remember so that we don't forget in the present. One man said this, those who fail to remember from history are doomed to repeat it. A couple of weeks ago in this country, there was a response to your past. It's called the 4th of July. And the first time I've ever been in this country on the 4th of July, it was great, all the fireworks, all the fun. But John Adams said this about Independence Day. And so I don't really know much about it. I'll not claim to know much about it. But this is what John Adams said on the 2nd day of July, because he thought it was going to be on the 2nd of July. On the 2nd day of July, 1776 will be the most memorable epoch in the history of America. I am apt to believe that it will be celebrated by succeeding generations as the great anniversary festival. It ought to be commemorated as the day of deliverance by solemn acts of devotion to God Almighty.
Amen.
It ought to be solemnized with pomp and parade, with show, games, sports, guns, bells, bonfires, and illuminations from one end of this continent to the other, from this day forward and forevermore. You feel like saying amen at the end of that. And so, looking on in America, they've got the pomp and the parade and the show and the games and the sports and the guns and the bells and the bonfires and the illuminations. But what struck me was it ought to be commemorated as a day of deliverance by a solemn act of devotion to God.
Yeah.
And so, as I used this a couple of weeks ago, I asked that question, who here yesterday or on the 4th of July started the 4th of July by saying, this is a solemn act of remembrance for where you've brought us from, God?
Good.
To how this country was founded and started. And where did we go wrong? And please don't take this as me judging, because my country is as bad. And on the same day, on the 4th of July, I was at a pool party and with all the guns, bells, bonfires, and illuminations. And in the bedroom, I was just going down to relax. And there's a picture on the wall of the first prayer in Congress. And in the first prayer of Congress, they were all like this on the chairs, remembering what was on your money, in God we trust.
Yeah.
And so just like it says in Moses, it says, we can't go forward without you, God. Without your presence, this is pointless. Without your anointing, this is pointless. And so the first prayer in Congress, they were on their knees before God Almighty saying, without you, we can go no further. Without you leading this country, it is pointless. And so I believe that this is a time where the church in this country is going to rise up and be counted, not as judgmental, arrogant Christians, but as a people of love.
Amen. Yeah.
As a people that will carry the gifts of the Spirit, that will not point out and judge, but say, I want to reveal a God who loves you.
Yeah. Amen.
And through that, you will be asking, how do I know this person? How do I see the face of the King that brings life? Mario Murillo says that once we are delivered and saved, we'll declare that the future is not what it used to be. When you truly encounter God, when you truly know Jesus, I've heard of so many Christians, well, my church has taken the wrong stance on gay marriage. I mean, because they don't support it. So that's me, I'm out. If God can really be this way, or if God can do these things, I can't do it. And so I think to myself, if you're so easily swayed with the wind, have you ever really known God? Have you ever really encountered the true and living God? Because if you had, nothing that is happening right now will shape what your future is like. Amen. Nothing will shake you because you know the future. You're confident in your story. You're confident in your God. So whatever happens in the government, whatever happens in the media, will not shake you because you're standing on a firm foundation and a solid rock. And so I will declare that my future is not what it used to be because I trust in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords who will not change. And I'm repeating myself a lot for a reason because it's going to get in there. They have a purpose in this in Germany. In Germany, they are terrified of repeating the past. They do not want a Holocaust again. And so in all schools, they have to learn about the Holocaust. It's law. They have to remember because of what I said before. Those who fail to remember history are doomed to repeat it. And they are terrified of repeating it. So we as Christians, we need to learn from the past, from the good. It's like the film, The Good, The Bad, and The Ugly. We have to learn from the good. How have these churches that have been effective, how have they got there? Yeah. How are the churches now that are effective? Where did they start? How did it happen? Those ones that failed, why did they fail? Yeah. We have to look back so that right now we can learn and be effective and powerful. And so as we move forward, what does this look like? What does it look like putting into action, looking back? And it came for me at the start of the year as I was studying Proverbs. And I read about clouds. And so whenever I was in school, all the time, people used to shout at me, my teachers, David, get your head out of the clouds. Because I was a daydreamer. And my oldest son, Daniel, has inherited that. Sometimes I think he's deaf because he just sits there and he's... And if I haven't said his name a million times in this 3 weeks that I've been in America, Daniel, Daniel. And so sometimes that has a positive or it has a negative. But everyone loves to talk about the weather. It's our natural default. If we feel awkward, we're like, oh, it's a lovely day outside. It's a wee bit wet. The weather's good. Oh, it's a bit hot. But in Great Britain, the weather is still Britain's favorite topic of conversation. 3/4 of people discuss it more than anything else. It's the same in this country, I think. But over the last while, as I've read Proverbs, I want to read you the verse that brought about this whole message. And it was Proverbs 25, verse 13 to 14. And I'm going to read it from the Passion Translation. And I would urge you, this is a new translation written from the original Greek and Hebrew. And it's such a spirit-filled translation. It's exciting to read. You can't put it down. So I'd urge you, it's not as a full book form yet, but you can buy it in different Proverbs, Psalms, the love letters, which is Paul's letters to the churches. But it says this, a reliable, trustworthy messenger refreshes the heart of his master, like a gentle breeze blowing at harvest time, cooling the sweat of his brow. Clouds that carry no water and wind that brings no refreshing rain. That's what you're like when you boast of a gift you don't have. The message makes it clear. It says this in 14, like billowing clouds that bring no rain is the person who talks big but never produces. And so I thought to myself, as I seek to move forward, I need to think about what I carry as a spirit-filled Christian. And God spoke to me about the clouds. So clouds are so important because they either bring life or they carry destruction. they bring rain or they don't bring rain. But the most important thing is they all have the ability to carry rain. They were all created to carry something. And sometimes they don't. It's something that will change the atmosphere. In this country, it's easy to see the weather coming. But where I live, you can have all four seasons in one day like that without warning. It can be raining, sunny, snow, all within 10 minutes. And so we can't see it coming. But in this country, you can look ahead and you can see that cloud's carrying something. There's something different about that cloud that's coming. And so in the Bible, clouds are a metaphor for people that are filled with the glory of God. You can read that in Hebrews 12:1 and Revelation 1:7. But as you look back further in Numbers, the cloud represented the presence of God among his chosen people. When the cloud descended upon the Holy of Holies, the people knew our God is among us. He specifically wanted them to be known for his presence. And that's what made the children of Israel stand out above everyone else, because their God was present at the very center of who they were. He was with them. He defined who they were. He is the one who gave them victory or didn't. And so as we move forward to the New Testament, we are the clouds. We are his representation. We are his very presence on this earth. When the curtain was torn in two, we all get access to the Father. We are the presence. And so that excites me. That we don't have to go through someone else to get into the presence of God. We have it living within us. Wind is an emblem of the Holy Spirit and bringing life. In John 3:6-8, in the 8 it says, the wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. Rain often points to teaching and the revelation truths that refresh and water the seeds of spiritual growth. So what we carry is important, because if we are empty, then the people around us are not going to encounter the living God. Like I said last night, your encounter has eternal consequences, because there are people around you who need to encounter the living God through you. They will see no one else. They will hear no one else. They may be open to no one else. And so Isaiah 55:8-11 in the New Living Translation puts it like this. I'll read this. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you can imagine. For just as high as the heavens are, just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. And verse 10 says this, the rain and snow come down from the heavens and stay on the ground to water the earth. They cause the grain to grow, producing seed for the farmer and bread for the hungry. It is the same with my word. I send it out and it always produces fruit. It will accomplish all I want it to, and it will prosper everywhere I send it. But in verse 10, the rain and the snow, you and me come down from heaven as we sit in the presence of the Lord, as we want to encounter him, as we seek him, and we say, God, we need you today as we are out representing you and carrying your fresh rain and your fresh snow. So we come down from heaven and we stay on the ground and we water the earth. Does that sound like what we do? We water the earth. We bring life. We cause grain to grow. We cause people to grow. We cause people to produce seed that will feed the hungry. So as clouds, we are called to carry rain and snow. It all looks different. What comes out of one cloud is different than what comes out of the other. But it all produces life where it hits. God's anointed people are to be clouds carried by the wind of the Holy Spirit. As your spirit filled, then your spirit led, that brings refreshing truth to his people. Amen. When we're empty, we're like clouds without rain. One great theologian called Dr. Seuss says this, the storm starts when the drops start dropping. When the drops stop dropping, then the storm starts stopping. The storm starts when the drops start dropping. When the drops stop dropping, then the storm starts stopping. And so let me bring a clearer picture to this. Is there a picture of the flower, the yellow flower? So a few weeks ago, I always say a few weeks ago, it could be months, years, but a few weeks ago, I had this vision. And it was of this flower, and I seen this flower representing me, and it was filled just so that one drop was coming out. One drop was hitting the ground. And below it, there was this tiny patch. There was this big patch of barren land. And in this tiny patch, there was just green starting to grow from this one drip. And so my one drip wasn't making much of an effect, but it was making an effect. So the storm starts when the drop starts dropping. And so I was like, God, it's not very encouraging. Why am I having this vision? And so I can't remember if it was in prayer or worship or where it was, but as I closed my eyes again, I looked up and I seen thousands of these flowers above me. And as all thousands of these flowers were operating out of overflow of just one drip, I looked back down and the ground below was flourishing with life and growing. And so as we come together out of overflow, not coming here to be fed on a Sunday, it's good to be fed, but coming already fed, coming operating out of not of massive overflow, but even a drip. We're coming here ready to combine together to say, God, we want to bring life and hope to people. So as we are learning to use the gifts of the Spirit, as we're learning to use the prophetic, we're learning how to pray for people to be healed, we need to be dripping with overflow. Because when the drops stop dropping, then the storm starts stopping. It's going to only go as far as his church are willing to take it right now. Because if you don't take it, someone else is going to take the mantle. Someone else out there is asking for Elijah's double portion. And they're going to get it. 2 Peter says this of people that are operating out of emptiness. These people are useless as dried up springs or as mist blown away by the wind. They are doomed to blackest darkness. He says, I don't want lukewarm people in my church. I heard Pastor Vern saying it last night. I don't want lukewarm people in my church. It's going to cause so much destruction. Because people are still going to look at them and say, they're Christians. They carry the hope of glory. Whereas it should be their Christians. This is what I've heard about. This is what I want. As I traveled to Africa, I've been there quite a few times, and last year, the picture of Edian, last year I was there leading a team, and there was a drought on, and this guy is Edian, he's the happiest man in the world, and he lives in one of the poorest countries in the world, and his heart was to reach all 3,000 AIDS orphans in his town with education and food, and so he's doing that. And so we were there, he says, David, you need to start praying for rain. And it's not something we pray for very often in Northern Ireland because we're usually praying for the rain to stop. But we said, okay, we're going to start praying for rain. And so a couple of days after we started praying for rain, we seen a couple of clouds. And Adam goes outside and he goes, oh, it's coming. It's a coming. And he's doing exactly this. Oh! He makes that noise. And so we all went out ready. And the cloud came and the cloud passed and nothing. The empty cloud brought disappointment because this land was dry. And Adian says, we need to pray because I have to plant my seeds for harvest. Without that harvest, we're lost. And so a couple of days later, these clouds are coming and Adian came out again. I'll not do the dance. He went out again and he said, the clouds are coming. And the clouds came and the clouds brought rain for 5 minutes. And so the shower just hit the ground, you know. It's like a weak handshake, you know. Doesn't do much. Just makes you think, oh, come on, we need the real thing. And so it had a little bit of life in it, but it was just a little bit. It wasn't what was needed. But then 2 days later, I say 2 days, it was maybe longer. But 2 days later, Adrian goes outside, I guess, he goes, David, it's here, it's really here. And as we looked in the distance, we seen the thunder and the lightning. And we sang the Garth Brooks song, Thunder Only Happens When It's Raining. We didn't really. But we knew the rain was coming because we seen that this cloud was different. This cloud was black and it was billowing up to the sky, and we knew something is coming and something's stirring. This is different. And the atmosphere changed. You know what it's like around here with storms. The atmosphere changed. And so some of us even went in and got our suave and we're ready to have a shower, because in Africa showers are really bad. And so next thing, the thunder and lightning came and the clouds poured and down on top of us like I have never seen before. Within a few minutes, the water was like this and it was flooding everywhere. But in the middle of it, this pastor took his shoes off, his good shoes, and he was dancing in the rain. He's going, hallelujah! He's a Pentecostal. He was dancing in the rain and the cooks were out and they were dancing about and, oh. Because when a cloud came that carried what it was supposed to, it brought life. The next day they were out planting their seeds for the harvest. The joy that it brought these people when a cloud came that actually carried what it was supposed to. And so the moral of the story is that the world is in desperate need of life-bringing clouds. People that are filled with the Spirit to overflowing, to want to bring life to those around them. And it doesn't matter if it's just a drip, as long as you're overflowing. Because as the church, we will make a difference. Every single cloud has the ability to carry rain. So do you want to carry rain? Do you want to be like it says in Isaiah, that we bring snow and we bring rain that brings life and harvest and abundance? I want to leave a trail behind me. And so the story of the Samaritan is a perfect example of this. The pompous, arrogant, religious people went past the man on the side of the road. I don't have time. I have to go and preach tonight. Do they not know who I am? I have to pray on this specific corner at this time so that people will see me in my beautiful robes and saying my beautiful prayers in public. I can't touch him. He's unclean. I'll not be able to do my rituals in the temple. They were clouds that were supposed to carry rain and didn't bother. But then the Samaritan, the least likely of them, came along and he was carrying the rain. Amen. And he carried it in abundance, even so much that he brought the man to the inn and he said, whatever his bill is, I will come back and pay it. I will pay what it takes for this man to be restored. Yeah. Are we willing to pay for what it takes for people to be restored to what they once were? The Daily Telegraph in the United Kingdom had an article and it says this: researchers found our day-to-day lives, this is the British, are still characterized by traditional British activities like discussing the weather, enjoying fish and chips and drinking cups of tea. That's all I do, drink fish and chips and drink cups of tea. Drink fish and chips, eat fish and chips. It is so popular that even after England's football team beat Croatia to qualify for the World Cup, more men were talking about the weather than they were the football. Imagine more men here talking about the weather than the Super Bowl final. That's how bad it is. So Dr. David Lewis, a psychologist and director of research in Mind Lab International, said, we cling to traditions because they are comforting. We cling to talking about the weather because it's comforting. The church clings to talking about things God used to do, or the way church should be, or where the organ should be, or what hat you should wear, or whatever it is. We cling to things because it's comforting. He said, these cultural symbols serve as the unshakable foundations on which the British way of life is built. And so it's good. It's good for us to remember the goodness of God, the faithfulness of God, the physical altars we have, because they are symbols that are unshakable and build our foundations. But the church has got it wrong, where we are taking these cultural symbols and using them as religiosity, if that's a word. This is the way our church is. This is what we do. And we will not change. Social and technological changes make many of us feel anxious and stressed because by challenging accustomed ways of thinking and doing, because they challenge accustomed ways of thinking and doing things. It undermines our sense of competence and self-belief. So many people are scared of the Holy Spirit. So many people are scared of the gifts of the Spirit, of these clouds that carry thunderous rain. It scares them so much that they pass it off as a false move. or it's from the devil, or it's not relevant. Traditions offer a psychological comfort blanket by appearing permanent and unchanging. Yeah. It's good for us to talk about the weather, because when it's awkward and we've nothing else to talk about, we can talk about the weather. So whenever we're asked awkward questions like, what's God saying to you today? How many people have you told about Jesus in the last week? When's the last time you led someone to the Savior? When's the last time you put yourself out to pray for someone who needed prayer for healing? When's the last time you give beyond your means because the Spirit led you to do it? What's the last book you read that encouraged you to go further with God? What's the last scripture you memorized so that you could call on it in times of need? Like David said, I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. It's keeping me right. When these hard questions come, we can talk about the weather. We can talk about the traditions of the church. Did you hear about our great program last week? We got 500 kids into VBS. Two of them are now coming to the church. These are realities of the modern day Western church. We're not called to uphold church traditions, but live a life of love and biblical truth. By providing, he goes on to say that by providing this sense of stability and predictability, they help reassure us everything will turn out for the best, so encouraging a more positive and optimistic view of the future. So this thing that came out in the news a few weeks ago, any churches that were rocked by it, it's okay to be rocked and rethink of your legislation and stuff, but churches that were rocked by it, do they really trust in the true and living God? Bono hits it square in the head. He says this. He's a great theologian too, apparently. Religion is what you are left with after the Holy Spirit has left the building. And so many of our churches, the Holy Spirit has completely left the building. You can't tell what's going on. But in here, I'm so happy to say, as soon as I walked in here last night, I was hit by the Spirit and filled beyond belief. Traditions are also a source of tremendous pride. Did you see the beautiful chandelier we got in the front? I know I'm poking fun. Please forgive me. But also, as I was looking back and thinking of the 4th of July when I was writing this sermon, I thought there were so many people filled with pride of their country, which is a great thing. But what I noticed is that there are so many people in churches that are more proud of their country than they are of their God. That their country comes before their God. It's good to be proud of this country. It's good to be proud of your flag. But it's even more to be proud of your God and who He is in your workplace. Are you proud to stand up for your God? A well-known American writer said once that while everyone talked about the weather, nobody seemed to do anything about it. And so I don't want to be known as someone who doesn't do anything about what God has called me to do. I want to be faithful when He puts something in my heart. I'm going to respond, even if I look like an idiot. Tells me in the Bible not to call anybody an idiot, but it's myself I'm talking about. And so God, I want to put myself out there. And like I tried to get across last night, most of the time I don't have a clue what I'm doing. But I'm Spirit-filled and Spirit-led. And I'm saying, God, whatever it is, if it scares me, if it's new, I'm going to go for it. I'm going to trust You. I'm going to seek You. I'm going to ask You. I'm going to ask advice from my peers. I'm going to say to the people, test this. Because I need to be good at what I do for the sake of others. I need to be a cloud that carries abundant rain for the sake of others, for the sake of my land, for the sake of your land, for the sake of my family, for the sake of the church. If one gets it, someone else will get it. The seeds that I plant and water will bring a harvest. And they will plant and seed and bring a harvest. And they will plant and seed. Wikipedia describes clouds as a visible mass. Some of us more visible than others. I'm a bit bigger than I was 3 weeks ago when I came to this great country full of McDonald's. And I haven't even had a McDonald's. Wendy's. But we are a visible mass. We are to model and demonstrate the life of Jesus in the way of his kingdom. Don't just be a visible mass that's an eyesore. Be a visible mass that brings life and beauty. And when people see you coming, they sing that song. When you walk into the room, everything changes for the good. He's saying to me, I want you to be my franchise, David. He's saying to you, I want you to be my franchise. You're my dominoes. Whenever I walk into a Domino's here, it should be the same as a Domino's in Northern Ireland. They don't have all these different rules here where we have different seating plans and our pizzas are different and we have different structures. You are my franchise here. So every single thing that represents me is represented in you. Everyone is trained efficiently so they know what they're talking about. And so I want you to be my franchise. I am saying you are my representative. You are my ambassadors. This is not your home. He wants us to move from a casual interest in him, which is, yeah, that's my church. I go on a Sunday. It's great. No, I don't know too many people. Don't know their names. I go maybe on a Sunday every 4 weeks. I read my Bible maybe twice a month. That's a casual interest. He wants us to move to an uncontrollable interest. Where I'm saying, God, I cannot get enough of you. I cannot get enough of being with my family. I love this family that you have placed me in as a part of. And so, God, I want you to help me be effective in this family to build up and encourage those around me. One of the things God has been speaking to me about is just saying what you see. Do you get the thing catchphrase over here? No? So the phrase of that is say what you see. And so often as Christians, we do not say what we see in people. And I'm not talking about negative. Try and put that out of the way for now. I'm talking about the positive. Point out someone's beauty to them because even though they're beautiful, they might not know it and they might not feel it. Point out someone's gift. You have an amazing gift with children. You have an amazing gift at playing the guitar. Do you know you just have a spirit of encouragement about you? Start saying what you see to the people around you and your family. Make a habit of it because it's prophetic. It's declaring something to them that's going to build them up and push them forward. And so I got a physical demonstration of this as I was praying about it a few weeks ago. I brought little Reuben to the doctors and I was sitting there and there was this young girl, maybe 16, sitting with her mum. And her mum left to go to the doctors, and this young girl was sitting playing with Reuben. And I felt God, it was a bit awkward, I was sitting with a 16-year-old girl, and I felt God saying, tell her that she has an amazing gift with children, and that she will use it. And I was like, I've never done this before. I don't even know this girl. I'm good at pointing out to people I know and observing them. So eventually I got up the courage to say to this girl, I'm a Christian, and as I was sitting here, I felt God saying to tell you this. And she looked up and she was like, I've just been wondering about whether I should go and be a maternity nurse and work with kids. And I said, well, I think you should. You've got an amazing gift for it. And that's all it was. It was just being spirit-led to seek the opportunities to for a young girl who doesn't even know Jesus to point out a gift that you've seen or that God has put in your heart to give to her. So get into a habit of doing it. He wants us to move to uncontrollable interest. It's okay if people think you're crazy. Not if you actually are. But that guy can't get enough of the Word of God. He just is always speaking about God. And I don't mean in an annoying way where you're always preaching at people, but just in a way where you're always giving testimony out of the overflow of what God is doing and the goodness of God. People don't want to be preached at, even though I'm preaching at you. Think about a parched land in drought. Random showers don't work. An uncontrollable interest isn't a here and there and plugging in when need to. It is a God, I cannot move forward without you. Just like Moses said, without your presence, this is all futile. Without your presence, I cannot do this. And so if we learn to get up in the morning and say, God, without your presence, I seriously cannot do this. The miraculous is going to start appearing in our lives. He wants our lives to reflect his heart. Amen. So what's going in will come out. Yes. It's like a car engine. Back in Northern Ireland, our diesel is really expensive, probably four or five times the price of yours. And so people make their own diesel. It's not a good idea. But when you drive behind a car that makes its own diesel, the smoke and the fumes and the blackness coming out is disgusting. And so whatever fuel you put into your body, we're not talking physically, we're talking spiritually. There's going to be consequences of what comes out. And so you think it's not dangerous watching something with a naked woman? Or you think it's not dangerous to watch things that are filled with filth? You think it's not dangerous now and again to say things or have jokes that are not representing the Father? And we're all guilty of it. What goes in will come out somewhere. And so I want what's going into my body to be affecting what's coming out so that I am a life-giving cloud that's full of the Spirit of God. Become something that gets the attention of the world. And so as I was thinking about that, I was praying a few weeks ago. Like I say, I always say a few weeks. I was praying a few weeks ago. And the Lord said to me about clothing myself in his presence. And so if you look back to the original Hebrew of that, it actually means smear yourself with my presence. Smear yourself with my presence. And he's saying, I want people to see my visible presence on you. So as you draw near as the cloud that's coming close to people, they will see, my goodness, there is something about you. You are carrying something. Because you're smeared with the presence, you're clothed in the presence of God. What you wear says something about your character. How you dress says something about your taste. And so what I wear as the presence of God will tell people what my priorities are, what my heart is like, what my character is like, what my focus is like, what my purpose is found in. And the good news is we are not doing this alone. We all know about the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, but I want to finish by looking at another aspect of it, and that's the people that are around us and the people that have gone before us in the past to drive us forward to the future. Hebrews 12 verse 1 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run the race with perseverance, the race that is marked out before us. We have others around us on the same course, dealing with the same things, running in the same direction. When Nicola and I were at Dollywood a few weeks ago, it was such a waste of money. When we were at Dollywood a few weeks ago, we always were caught up walking in the wrong direction. And I said to Nicola, this is our life. We always seem to be going against the flow. We always seem to be going the wrong way that other people are going, and I love it. I love it. But there are others going the same direction as us. There might be small pockets of them in places, but they're going the same direction, and they have the same heart. So the first thing I want to remind us with this Hebrews 12 is that it's good to have heroes. It's good to look back to push us towards the future. It's good to look at heroes of the faith, to people that planted the church, to people that went out before us, to people that spent months on boats to get to the mission field. Why did they do it? Why were they driven to do these things? It's good to learn from their lives to push us forward. And I imagine them with this Hebrews 12, the great cloud of witnesses. I imagine them in heaven going, let's keep going. Go for it. I can see what's on the other side of the hill. I can see what is in front of you. God has revealed it to us. We know where you're going. Keep going. You're so close. We couldn't see it, but we want to push you forward. There's a great cloud of witnesses up there cheering us along and patting us on the back, saying, keep going. And so it's good to have heroes. It's good to be aware of them. It's good to study them. And it's good to have spiritual mentors and fathers and mothers. Yes. And so I encourage you, no matter what age you are, you don't have a spiritual father or mother, get one. Amen. Pray in the Spirit and say, God, give me someone. Ask for guidance. Make it clear to me, God, I need someone in my life to hold me accountable, to pull me up, to tear me down in the right ways that are going to build me back up. Whatever it may be, I need these people in my life. Heroes aren't just for the secular world or for fiction. They are for reality. Amen. They are everyday people that are around us. And if you don't know what a hero is, this is it. Someone who reminds you of who you want to be. Who do you want to be? Just like Timothy and Paul, who do you want to be? The purpose is not just to admire, but to imitate, like Paul said, imitate me, because I am imitating Christ himself. The second thing is, view your life as a race and not a stroll through the park. It says here that we are in a race. There's a purpose in a race. There's a reason why we don't have televised walking competitions. Because they're boring. There's nothing at stake. Yes, I won the walking prize at school. I was the walking champion in our high school. There's no purpose in just walking. We're in a race that has consequences. There's a prize for finishing the race. There's a purpose in the race. And a race has something at stake. So he is saying, keep going in this race. Success is being faithful prior to the results. God, I know what me being faithful to you is going to achieve. I know from looking back to the future that what you have done in my life, I may not see the results right now. I may not see the harvest of the seeds that I plant, but I know that you will be faithful and the results will come. Jesus, it goes on to say in Hebrews 12, that it was the joy set before him that drove him up that hill at Calvary. As he was going up, when he was beaten and torn and bloody, he was looking ahead to the joy, saying, God, I know, Father, I know that what I am doing now, what it will accomplish for my bride, my church. And so I want to be a faithful bride. I want to be a bride that whenever we meet the Father, he will say, well done, good and faithful servant. Bring your bus full of people in. We'll repair the tires and might send you out again. But I want to be a faithful servant. I want my bride to be a bride that represents the character of my husband. My wife can represent me if I'm not there. She knows my character. She knows who I am. And I trust her to do that. So can God trust us as his bride to represent all that he is? Sometimes we're going to get distracted in the race. Little Daniel in a sports day at school, he's not a winner. Like, I mean, in a good sense. He doesn't care about winning. All he cares about is seeing his mum and dad at the side. And so as he ran, he was like, we call him Twinkle Toes because he runs on his toes. And he was running and he was just so busy looking for us waving. He didn't come last this time, but he still ran the race, and he ran it with the right heart and the right character, and he finished it. It wasn't about winning it, but he finished it, and he finished it with a great character. He finished it with a great attitude. And sometimes whenever we're running, that's only when we feel the excess weight. So whenever Nicola was pregnant, I said, right, Nicola, I'm going to eat whatever you eat. Whatever you crave, I'll crave. I'll just make you feel really good about yourself. But whenever Nicola had Reuben, she was disciplined and she stopped eating all the cravings. And I kept going. And so I kept going until Christmas. And then after Christmas, I started to run. And it's only when I started to run that I realized there's bits that weren't there before. There's bits hanging out that weren't hanging out before all this. And so for some Christians, we've been out of the race so long that we don't even realize the hindrances that are there. They might not necessarily be sinful or bad, but they're hindrances. Each of us will have personal hindrances that are different. Each of us will have things that will affect how we as clouds carry his presence. And so for us, it's getting into the presence of God and saying, God, what excesses do I need to get rid of? And this backs up what you said earlier, Pastor Vern. What do I need to get rid of to be an effective cloud and presence carrier, God? Yeah. Amen. Christians don't have armor in their back for a reason. Ephesians 6 talks about the armor of God and telling us that the battle is won. The reason we don't have it on our backs is because we do not turn and run. Amen. We have our brothers at arms beside us. We already have the victory. When it talks about the shoes of peace, they have like studs on them that firmly ground you where you are. We are not retreating. The church is not retreating. Some churches may look like they are, but we are not retreating. We don't need armor on our back because we have each other in this race, pushing each other on. And even more important, we have the advocate.
Amen.
Yeah. And so as I finish, I want to remind you that we are to be the presence of God every day, everywhere. It's not a choice that we make just on a Sunday, but it's every day, everywhere. We are to model and demonstrate what it is to be a kingdom carrier, a life giver, an atmosphere changer. We are to display and declare the glory of God. When we learn as individuals to steward and to carry his presence in our daily lives, that is when we will see the effects of the invading kingdom of God. When we personally learn to carry the presence of God, when we come together collectively, it will be like a mighty explosion.
Yes.
As we pray, it tells us in Revelation that when we're praying, we're sending up the parts for the bomb. This is the Message translation, probably. We're sending up the parts for the bomb, and as those incense rise before the throne, God is putting them together, and he's building the bomb, and he's just going to, he's throwing it down, and it's just going to explode with answers to what we're asking for. And so as we, as individuals, learn to carry and steward that presence and say, God, I need filled. I need to be filled. As we come together, as we put our prayers and our requests and we knock and knock and knock, those prayers are going up and God's building one mighty bomb so that someday soon he is going to throw down that double portion where this church is going to be set alight and his bride is going to be known for what it was supposed to be known. I want to be a transformed person because transformed people transform people. I stole that one. But transform people, transform people. So I want to be known for someone that brings transformation.
Amen.
And so as I finish, maybe the worship team can come up. I wanna leave you with a couple of verses that God's put in my heart recently. And they're from Amos 5 and Amos 9. And so what I want you to do, I want to invite you. I'm not a really great believer in that you have to come to the front. But some people, God tells them to come to the front, and it's for a reason, because he's asking you to step out, like the children of Israel had to step into the water of the Jordan before it moved. Sometimes that's God saying, when you step out, you will encounter me. For others, I think it's important that we learn as a church to pray for each other where we are. It's not just about the people that are up the front. You're as anointed as anyone up the front. And so if that's what God lays in your heart, pray for each other. But I want to pray that we are filled to overflowing with the presence of God, that we will be a visible mass that represents what the kingdom is. And so I want to read these verses. In Amos 5, it says, a warning to come back and live. Now, this is what the Lord says to the family of Israel. Come back to me and live. Come back to the Lord and live. Otherwise, he will roar through Israel like a fire. It says in verse 8, it is the Lord who created the stars, the Pleiades and Orion. He turns darkness into morning and day into night. He draws up water from the oceans and pours it down as rain on the land. The Lord is his name. How you hate honest judges, how you despise people who tell the truth. You trample the poor, stealing their grain through taxes and unfair rent. Therefore, though you build beautiful stone houses, you will never live in them. Though you plant lush vineyards, you will never drink of the wine. Do what is good and run from evil so that you may live. Then the Lord God of heaven's armies will be your helper, just as you have claimed. I hate all your show and pretense and hypocrisy, of your religious festivals and solemn assemblies. That sounds like a lot of churches. Away with your noisy hymns of praise. I will not listen to the music of your harps. Instead, I want to see a mighty flood of justice, an endless river of righteous living. It's not just about your beautiful praise and worship or your religious ceremonies. I want to actually see action. I want to see a visible demonstration of my kingdom breaking into the lives of the people that come into contact with you. And so if you do this, if you live righteously and let there be a flood of justice from you as a body of people, this is what he says in Amos 9, a promise of restoration. In that day I will restore the fallen house of David. Do we know what the house of David was? The house of David was like a rebellion because the presence of God was only in the Holy of Holies. But King David was so hungry after the presence of God that he said, God, I'm going to open up a temple that is 24/7 praise and worship because I want your presence and I hunger for your presence and I need your presence. And King David didn't get into trouble because he danced in his underwear before God. And his wife didn't want them after it. But he just didn't care. He threw everything off that hindered him so he could dance before the Lord. And he said, I need your presence. I don't care what has happened in the past where people had to go into the Holy of Holies. I want it. Yeah. And out of a right heart, where God said, I love David's heart. He's a man after my heart. I'm going to give him my presence. I will restore the fallen house of David. That 24/7 access to me. I will repair its damaged walls from the ruins. I will rebuild it and restore it to its former glory. And it says this in verse 13. The time will come, says the Lord, when the grain and the grapes will grow faster than they can be harvested. Let me read that again. The time will come, says the Lord, when the grain and the grapes will grow faster than they can be harvested. There is coming a day when the bride gets kicked into action, that the harvest is going to be so much that we will not know what to do with ourselves. The churches will be useless because they'll be too small. People will be getting healed on a daily basis. It will be the new normal. And I know that day is coming and is already starting to come. And so, God, I want to usher that in, that time that is coming when the grapes will grow faster than they can be harvested. Please, God, send that. But for that to happen, we have to be a people who learns to carry the presence of God. We want to be dry bones that are brought to life. We want to be a church that is living as one, with one heartbeat, with one focus, with one mind. And so if you want to stand, we want to pray that. Maybe there's people in here that just haven't even encountered God in the way that they need to push them forward or to waken them up. And so, God, I ask for people to encounter you tonight, Father, that will change their whole mindset. Amen. God, if there's people in here tonight, which I believe you're laying on my heart, that their spouses are holding them back, I just pray for divine revelation and ignition within their hearts, Lord, that you will set them ablaze for you, God. Father, I just pray for a compassion in here for people tonight that don't know you, God, because we need you to break our hearts for the people around us. Father, help us to weep over those who are lost. Help us to weep over those who need you, Lord, that will drive us to compassion, that will drive us to action, God. Yeah.